Well, we're coming up on an election, ladies and gentlemen, and if you can believe it, on Labor Day, the president began to sound like a Republican. Why? Because he wants to win.
Exactly. Well, can you blame him, you know? Talking about the economy, lots of new proposals to help the economy, including tax relief for businesses. But economists doubt that any of these plans are going to help the Democrats in this year's elections. Here's Paul Strand with that story.
The president's latest proposal, a $200 billion tax cut, letting businesses write off new investments in plants and equipment from now to the end of next year. The president started the week by pushing for at least $50 billion in infrastructure spending on roads, railways, and runways.
We're talking investments in tomorrow that are creating hundreds of thousands of private sector jobs right now.
Economists question if the new suggestions will be enough.
What you hope is if you can throw enough small things at the economy, enough, shoot enough small bullets, that you do enough to actually be able to win this war against what is a very fragile recovery.
Despite the president's new business tax cut proposals, many small businesses would prefer an extension of the Bush tax cuts, which would help them. The president doesn't want to keep the tax cuts for the upper incomes and small businesses, but only for the middle class.
The 98% of the population for whom we would extend the Bush tax cuts, that's where you're going to get a high level of consumption.
But Obama wants to let the Bush tax cuts for people making more than $250,000 a year expire in December. A move economist Mark Zandi says is unwise in this fragile economy.
High-income households are psychologically very, very fragile. They've seen their nest egg significantly diminished because of the decline in stock values and housing values.
Whatever Obama proposes, Republicans will say it's just politicking.
We always like to see deathbed conversions. Like, they're just flailing around.
The president says the Republicans are just the party of no.
If I said the sky was blue, they say no. If I said fish live in the sea, they'd say no.
It allows them to define the Republicans as the party of no. If Democrats seize on that opportunity, I think that's a great opportunity for Democrats.
The problem for the president and the Democrats, though, is that it's not just Republicans who are saying no to his policies, it's voters, and in huge numbers.
There are races here in which you have Democrat incumbents down 10, 11 points. People are simply angry. They're angry about the economy, about not having jobs, and they're angry about Obamacare.
Republican strategist Kevin Madden says Republicans are almost sure to take the House, which could mean the Senate, too.
Ever since post-World War II, the House has never flipped without bringing a Senate with it, even when nobody expected it to happen.
If Republicans win control of Congress, it is because voters are voting against Democrats.
Republican-based voters can't wait to get to the polls to register their vote on Election Day. Democrats are having a hard time even getting out of bed in the morning.
Paul Strand, CBN News, Washington.
You know, it does sound like a deathbed conversion. I'm going to give you 1 year, and you've got to go out and spend all kinds of money. And if you do that, I'll let you write it off your taxes. Well, you've got to earn money in order to owe any taxes, for starters. And what business is going to say, well, I'm going to build a huge plant, you know, because I'm going to get to write it off my taxes? It doesn't make any sense. They can borrow much money right now, but they're not doing it. Mm-hmm. And so, and this is, again, it's for big business. These things are for big business. And the little businessman, he says, I'm going to trash you. I'm not going to let you have tax cuts.
Well, you know what I think people feel also, at least I surely do, is we've probably never been, in recent years anyway, in a more devastating situation economically. You feel like the experts aren't in charge, like that you don't even really know who they are. The people who are in charge don't seem to have an answer. And people don't want to hear any more rhetoric to get votes. They want them to fix economy.
Well, he had shovel-ready projects. They are not shovel-ready, and they weren't ready to go. Now he's talking about what is really a good thing is fixing the infrastructure, but this, it'll take years. And to think that you're going to somehow open a couple hundred billion dollars and it's going to flood in, it won't happen. All these nostrums don't work. If there was a consistent program of pro-business, lower taxes, fiscal probity, we'd see something going ahead. But they're not sending that message. Instead of that, they sent this crazy health care bill across, and the American people are confused about that. Well, Wendy, we've said enough. Tell us about the happiness in the news today, if there is any.
Well, we'll get to that in just a moment, Pat. But first, Maryland investigators have ordered a doctor to stop performing abortions in that state. They're looking into claims of a botched abortion at a controversial clinic. The Philadelphia Inquirer reports an abortionist named Stephen Brigham is accused of trying to cover up the mistake. The paper says he put a bleeding, semi-conscious patient in a private vehicle to take her to the hospital instead of calling an ambulance. The Maryland Board of Physicians ordered Brigham to stop performing abortions there. The paper reports his medical license has been revoked, relinquished, or suspended in five states over the last 18 years. Well, more than a quarter of a million Christians visit Jerusalem's Garden Tomb every year. It's the place where many believe Jesus Christ rose from the dead. The site is considered holy ground to many believers, but now it's in danger of being damaged by a construction project next door, a project that's being funded by a Muslim group. Chris Mitchell has that story from Jerusalem.
Richard Marion, the director of the Garden Tomb, showed CBN News this 15-foot wall being built above the Garden Tomb's 105-year-old wall.
And now in the last few weeks, the cemetery above has built this wooden construction into which they are now ready to pour hundreds of tons of concrete on top of our wall.
Jerusalem's Islamic Waqf is building the wall to enlarge a Muslim cemetery. Marion fears the new wall could bring on a catastrophe.
And just beneath it, we have three or four areas where Christians are worshiping every day. And so we have the potential here in heavy rain or in snow, or even in one of those earth tremors that Jerusalem is famous for. It only needs one of these events to happen, and this new wall could collapse. It could kill 200 visitors, pilgrims, and tourists in the garden worshiping.
The new wall violates three local building codes. It does not have a city permit. It's supposed to be built 10 feet away from any existing structure and get the permission of its neighbor.
They have never sought my permission. We are now in active discussion with them, and I am negotiating with them, and I cannot allow them to build this wall until they prove to me beyond all reasonable doubt that this wall is going to be safe.
A spokesman from the Muslim cemetery told CBN News they do not have a license, but claim the new wall is safe. The mayor's office told CBN News they will make sure the building is legal in order to keep Jerusalem open to visitors from all over the world. The Garden Tomb attracts many international visitors.
We walk through the garden. We're hearing groups of people praising God, worshiping Him in every language from everywhere, and we have taken people through the garden, literally from every corner of the globe.
But the wall is not the only construction Marion worries about.
Golgotha is mentioned in John chapter 19, where Jesus was led outside the city wall that's 200 meters behind you, out through the gate, into a place called Golgotha, is what John chapter 19 says.
Marion says recent digging on top of Golgotha, next to the Garden Tomb, threatens the hill known as the Place of the Skull. Many believe Jesus was crucified here, where even in the rock face itself, the face of a skull can be seen.
Above Golgotha, in the last few days, bucket by bucket, load by load, a lot of dirt has been imported above the rock and below those graves on the skyline. I've known for some weeks they were thinking of building a minaret up there.
Marion wants to make sure Golgotha and the Garden Tomb remain intact.
This is a very important Christian holy site, and we just want to live here in peace and provide this amazing opportunity for Christians all around the world to come here and to continue to worship, to be exposed to the gospel.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, The Garden Tomb.
And you can find more of Chris Mitchell's reports from Israel at his blog, Jerusalem Dateline. Just go to our website, cbnnews.com. Pat, this is going to be so disturbing to so many believers.
It is, because we believe firmly the Garden Tomb is where Jesus was buried. It is a very important site. The thing is, Wendy, I was over there 2 or 3 years ago and looked at some of the refuse that's being taken out by the Muslims from in under the Temple Mount itself. They're digging up priceless antiquities and just dumping them out in bucket loads, you know, using front-end loaders and heavy machinery just to gut out underneath the Temple Mount a place for a big mosque they're building. They don't have any regard whatsoever for the sanctity of these sites or for the preservation of Roman antiquities. Because so you could see some of the things that were dumped in the trash that dated back to the Roman times. I mean, these are priceless antiquities, and the Muslims just don't care. They don't care. And they have desecrated some tombs that were there that they took over that were sacred to the Jews. I mean, it's an incredible thing that the government of Jerusalem would allow this to happen. Maybe they'll stop it. Wendy?
Pat, Tropical Storm Hermine rolled into South Texas early today with winds up to 65 miles an hour. The storm could dump up to a foot of rain in some areas and is expected to cause some flash flooding. Mexican emergency officials evacuated 3,500 people from the area across the border from Brownsville, Texas. Schools on both sides of the border canceled today's classes.
We just basically got some snacks and some flashlights in case the electricity goes out.
Hermine's path is similar to the one Hurricane Alex took in late June. Remnants of Hermine will be felt as far north as Oklahoma and Kansas in the coming days. Well, experts are warning that aftershocks in New Zealand could go on for weeks. There have been more than 100 shocks since the earthquake struck over the weekend. Just last night, there were 20. Scientists say that the aftershocks might come less often in the coming weeks, but they won't necessarily get smaller. The worst could still be to come. The original quake created a new 11-foot fault line. Nobody was killed, but many homes, buildings, and roads were wrecked.
We're continuing to check all of the infrastructure across the city. Clearly, we can't get to it all in the first few hours of an event like this. It's going to take us probably days, if not weeks, to complete that assessment.
Damages are estimated at around $2 billion. Well, can money buy you happiness? Well, maybe a little bit more. Economists say the more money you make, the happier you are, but only up to a point. According to a new study from Gallup and the National Institute for Aging, people are happiest if they earn about $75,000 a year, so all their basic needs are met. Earning more than that can increase your sense of success, but it doesn't necessarily make you happier. Pat, I think that's kind of interesting.
It is. You know, Wendy, the Bible says, having food and raiment, let us therefore be content. So what they're saying is, in today's inflationary environment, if you've got $75,000 and you've got a family and you have to pay taxes and all the other expenses, you'll have enough to meet your needs for shelter, transportation, food, and clothing. And the Bible says, having had that, be content. Don't try to go out and rival Bill Gates, or you probably won't succeed.
Yeah, exactly.
And you just find yourself frustrated. So, will that make you happy? I don't know, but at least it'll take some of the fear of the wolf being at your door, Terry.
Contentment can be a fine art.
Contentment, amen.
Well, coming up, meet a first lady with rock star status and find out why she declared 3 days of nationwide prayer and fasting in her country.
Coming up later, the quarterback who revived a city on life support.
A city that just needed somebody to believe in them.
Drew Brees talks about overcoming adversity.
I was given a 25% chance of coming back.
Living his dream.
It's surreal to think that it actually did happen.
And keeping the faith.
God does have a purpose for me that's much greater than football.
I know motivation is easy to find, but hard to keep. It's there with every New Year's resolution, every swimsuit season. Then it's gone. But now I am CurveSmart.
CurveSmart is a personal coaching system designed to keep you motivated like never before, only at Curves. Join now for just $30. CurveSmart gives you moment-by-moment feedback to keep you working at your peak. And it automatically adjusts to your body so you stay challenged. Stay challenged for just $30. Then, detailed progress reports show your muscle strength, calories burned, and how close you are to your goal. Now you have the knowledge you need to get the results you want.
I am CurveSmart.
Call today and join for just $30. Personal coaching from CurveSmart, only at Curves.
Tomorrow, meet the natural bodybuilder of the decade, and find out what this strong man was trying to hide.
If I could build this armor around myself, then nobody could hurt me again.
Plus, how this man dropped 150 pounds in a year without drugs or surgery.
Constantly setting those smaller goals got me here.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
The Congo, formerly called Zaire, was a troubled area, and a Marxist named Laurent Kabila came in and executed a coup, took over the country, and then there were many numbers of factions. He made he made deals with the people coming out of Zimbabwe, and it went on and on and on. And before it was finished, 3 million people died in some of the struggle. But his son, the younger man, was actually elected president of what is now called the Democratic Republic of Congo. And we didn't know too much about him, but now we've got a very encouraging story about his young wife, Marie Alve Kabila. She's not well known here, but she's a rising star in Africa. She's one of the youngest first ladies on the continent. She's a stirring, strong Christian. And George Thomas has her story from Kinshasa, which is the capital city of that nation.
A Google search of her name brings up very little personal details. But here on the streets of the Democratic Republic of Congo, Marie Alve Kabila is a rock star of sorts. When she's out in public, which is very rare, the crowds, well, they just can't get enough of her. Mrs. Kabila is the First Lady of the Democratic Republic of Congo. She's married to President Joseph Kabila, one of Africa's youngest leaders. She rarely does media interviews, or for that matter, speaks publicly. And so her participation in a recent Christian event drew national attention and came as a surprise to many in her country.
People of God, this is a very special day for me.
In a small church on the east side of the capital city of Kinshasa, hundreds of people gathered recently as Mrs. Kabila declared 3 days of nationwide prayer and fasting.
I am here to tell you that I will never be ashamed of my Lord's name. We need him desperately to heal our country.
The Democratic Republic of Congo, or DRC, is what some would say cursed by its natural resources. You name it, it has everything. Diamonds, copper, gold, cobalt, zinc, the list goes on. But for all its riches, the DRC is a mess. Politically, economically, socially, and according to Mrs. Kabila, spiritually dying.
Dear Father, our people are suffering. We need you, Lord.
According to the CIA, more than 5 million people have died here since 1998. From famine, violence, and disease, Eastern Congo, home to the majority of the country's wealth, is also ground zero of the worst war on the continent at the moment. Despite a peace agreement, government troops are still fighting to ward off rebel groups from taking control of the minerals. Hundreds of thousands of people have been displaced, and tens of thousands of women raped, tortured, and mutilated.
We have all the mineral wealth in the world. We are like the promised land, but we are flowing with death and destruction.
With the blessing of her husband, Mrs. Kabila launched a prayer campaign, placing billboards like this in all the major cities. She took to the airwaves, pleading for her countrymen to join her, and the response was overwhelming. For 3 days, Congolese around the country gathered in their churches.
The First Lady is setting an example for us and calling us to pray for each other.
And for someone who is incredibly shy, reserved, and often shuns the public spotlight, it was this image of their First Lady raising her hands and crying out to God that touched so many people. Theodore Mugalu serves as the presidential couple's spiritual advisor.
The First Lady is a strong person of faith. She knows that it's only through prayer that we can face the Goliaths of our culture. That's why these days are so important.
3 days after launching the prayer and fasting campaign, at a packed soccer stadium, tens of thousands of people gathered to worship and pray. Several of the country's top Christian artists were on hand to perform.
And why is this event so significant? You see, you have to understand, in the political history of the Democratic Republic of Congo, no sitting leader has ever called for days of prayer and fasting. And so what the First Lady is doing today is monumental.
I want you to know that the president is supporting us today, even though he's not here.
And even though it marked the end of the 3 days of prayer and fasting, Mrs. Kabila urged her countrymen not to stop, but to keep praying.
This is just the beginning. We want to be set free from the devil and the evil spirits that run to and fro in our nation. I believe the walls of Jericho are falling. God is going to set our nation free.
And once again, to the surprise of so many here, the First Lady, accompanied by a famous Congolese Christian singer, ended the prayer campaign by singing, asking for the Spirit of God to fall upon her nation. George Thomas, CBN News, Kinshasa, in the Democratic Republic of Congo.
That is good news. You know, the King of Belgium used that country as sort of his private purse, and they just raped, the Belgians raped that country. And, you know, they were in there, and if these people wouldn't provide so much rubber and so much, they cut their hands off. I mean, it was brutal the way they treated them.
Brutal. And the treatment of women today and young girls is still incredibly brutal there. Orphans Promise has a huge work that CBN is doing in Goma with the women. But you know, Pat, what's encouraging to me is the crisis now is internal. Yeah. So when you see God raising up a man and a woman internally to it's make a difference, that's pretty impressive.
You know, the work we did, we had about 5 million people came to the Lord through various evangelistic crusades and television and so forth. And those people are very spiritual. They're very hungry for God. And that would be a marvelous thing, but the First Lady, by all means, pray for her. What a marvelous saint she is, and she's going to prove to be a leader. I know the First Lady of the Ivory Coast came to see us. She was a dedicated believer. Her husband was a Christian. There are a number of leaders of African countries who are born-again Christians, and they just need some help and some prayer, but by all means, pray for what used to be called Zaire. It was called Congo, then Zaire, then back to Congo again. Terry?
Well, still ahead, he led the New Orleans Saints to their first Super Bowl win ever.
It's an unbelievable feeling just to have that trust and that confidence and that faith that if you do things the right way, good things will happen to you.
Drew Brees talks about football and faith after this.
Can you read my number?
Attention those on Medicare with diabetes. You may be eligible for an upgraded meter.
I am tired of stabbing my fingertips to test my blood glucose. There has got to be a better way.
If you're on Medicare with diabetes, then you need to know there's a new method for checking your blood glucose. You don't need to stab your fingertips anymore. This new Embrace meter is easier to use and nearly painless. And the best news? Is that Diabetes Care Club will send you one of these new meters.
This new method hurts less, and I don't have to stab my fingertips anymore.
Not only can I see my number, I can hear it too.
Your blood glucose reading is 89.
There's my number.
Find out why nearly 250,000 patients have joined Diabetes Care Club.
Call Diabetes Care Club.
Shipping is free, and so is the call.
Call 1-800-664-9966.
I'm glad I did.
I was in a lot of pain. I remember feeling, I don't want to have cancer. Why is this happening?
I went to pray with my 10-year-old. He said that he wished he had two hearts because one of them was breaking.
I had to reassure her a lot that I'm going to be okay. Things are going to be all right. You know, God's on our side.
This is one thing that Cancer Treatment Center does for people. They give them the courage and the strength to battle cancer.
When you first walk in that building, you almost feel like there's the presence of the Holy Spirit.
It is about the patient. It is only about the patient. And what is it that they need and what do they want?
Call now and we'll send you this free DVD that shows you how our very special team of experts and caregivers put you at the center of everything we do. Hope is alive at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
I don't really see how anyone can get through a life-threatening disease without the Lord in their life. He gives us the strength that we need to carry on.
Well, every September on Labor Day, the CBN staff gets together to worship, to pray, to seek the Lord's direction for this ministry. And yesterday, Pat spoke to us about God's favor. Let's take a look.
I want to talk to you about a fellow who you should know about. His name is Abraham. The word of the Lord came to him. He took him outside and said, "Look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then he said, "So shall your offspring be." Abraham said, "Okay, Lord, you said it. Amen. Let it be." That's what's called favor, guys. Grace, the definition, is unmerited favor. You don't analyze God's favor. You don't need to put it in a test tube. You don't need to sit around worrying about whether you're good enough. No, you're not good enough. No, you're not smart enough. We're not. None of us are. It's God's favor. Abraham wasn't good enough. He wasn't smart enough. And he sure wasn't virile enough because he hadn't had any kids. So something was going on. It was God.
God's favor. Who doesn't want it, right? Yeah. It was a great message. People really, I think, are hungry to know God's favor and his presence in their lives. And boy, looking back at people like Abraham, you can see that there's a pathway.
Well, you know, we had years ago, I asked for people to put their three lifetime prayer requests to us, and then we'd put them in a altar that's in our prayer room. And mine were very simple. I wanted wisdom. I wanted the anointing of God, and I wanted favor. Mm-hmm. And those prayer requests, 40, 50 years later, they're still the same. Yeah. And you want favor, and favor opens doors. It is incredible. But again, as I said, you can't analyze it. You don't have to analyze it. You don't have to say, "Well, I'm not good enough," or "I have to get better, and I've got to do it." It's favor, unmerited. That means you didn't deserve it. You don't deserve it.
And he just gave it.
He just gave it to you. And that's what Abraham had, and I hope the people apparently were encouraged. I like that message.
Very.
That's a good message.
It was a good message. And that's a great time of the year. We enjoy coming together.
Yeah, well, we have done that ever since we first started in 1961. We had the first prayer meeting on Labor Day. Well, Thursday, the NFL's regular season begins with the NFC Championship grudge match between the defending champions, the New Orleans Saints, and the Minnesota Vikings. And just before the Saints training camp, sports reporter Sean Brown caught up with Super Bowl champion quarterback Drew Brees. Drew talked about football, his family, and most of all, his faith.
It was the day that New Orleans Saints fans waited on for over 40 years, the day their beloved Saints would finally win the Super Bowl. It came on the leadership and arm of game MVP and quarterback Drew Brees, who did what many thought was close to impossible.
It's an unbelievable feeling. It's surreal to think that it actually did happen.
But a great story isn't just about the ending. It's also about the journey. Drew and his younger brother Reed grew up in Austin, Texas, and football wasn't his favorite sport.
Baseball was my favorite sport, and I played all sports. I was really just one of those kids that, you know, my brother and I were just sports junkies. I mean, every free second we had was out in the yard pitching to each other or tackling each other or, you know, playing tennis or, you know, just running around. I mean, whatever it was very always athletic.
But by high school, Drew excelled in football as a quarterback. He looked forward to playing at the college level, but in his junior year, he suffered a torn ACL. And at the time, his future in football looked dim.
I had seen a lot of my friends tear their ACLs, and some of them hadn't come back as good as they were before, you know, not as fast, not as mobile, whatever it might be. And so the thought of a torn ACL was devastating to me because I thought that I might be in the same boat as them, which was I wouldn't come back as strong.
One Sunday at church, something the pastor said changed everything.
I was 17 years old, sitting in church one day that, you know, with a torn ACL, crutches, just kind of wondering, you know, why if football were not here for me, or for sports weren't here for me, you know, what's my calling in life? You know, what's my purpose? What am I here to do? You know, what's God's purpose for me? And for some reason, it all hit me. His call to the congregation was that God was looking for a few good men to, you know, carry the torch and to represent the Christian faith and to lead. And I just remember thinking to myself, man, I'd like to be one of those few good men.
Drew became a Christian that day. With a new purpose, he was determined that nothing would stand in his way.
God does have a purpose for me that's much greater than football.
Drew went on to finish his high school football career with a 28-0 record. He spent the next 4 years at Purdue, where he led the Boilermakers to the 2001 Rose Bowl. And though they came up short, there were bigger things in store for Drew that year. He was drafted by the San Diego Chargers. He spent 5 seasons there until he dislocated his throwing shoulder while trying to recover a fumble. And once again, Drew's future in football was questionable.
I was given a 25% chance of coming back and playing by some. And that could very easily put a lot of doubt in your heart. But ever since, you know, that moment in high school, when I truly accepted the responsibility of being a Christian and accepting Jesus into my heart and knowing that I'm living for a lot more than myself, I'm living for Him and the call that we all have as Christians, I knew that my faith was strong, and that as long as I relied on that and knew that there was a plan, and I just had to believe it, I just had to trust it.
In just 2 months, Drew had fully recovered. But by then, the Chargers organization had decided to go with Philip Rivers as the starter. So Drew decided to move on. He had two choices: the Miami Dolphins, a team on the rise with championship potential, and the New Orleans Saints, a losing team in a city still picking up the pieces from Hurricane Katrina.
Here's Miami. Nick Saban was a first-year head coach the year before. They went 9-7. They won their last 7 in a row. I mean, they were a team on the up and up. And then here's New Orleans, which is a first-year head coach. You know, nobody knew what to expect out of Sean Payton. A city that had just been completely devastated by Hurricane Katrina, 85% of the city underwater. The team had been displaced, 3-13 record, coming back, hobbling back. And these are my choices. And so from an outsider's perspective, you would think that the obvious choice would be the Miami Dolphins. And yet when you get past the surface and dig a little bit deeper, you see the heart and soul of a city that just needed somebody to believe in them. And here I was, just needing somebody to believe in me.
During their visit to New Orleans, Drew and his wife Brittany saw the devastation of Hurricane Katrina with their own eyes.
I think that's when Brittany, you know, both looked at each other and thought, this is much more, you know, than just coming to be a part of a team. This is coming to be a part of something much greater, and that is the rebuilding of a city.
Drew signed with the Saints in 2006. 4 seasons later, he led them to not only their first Super Bowl, but to victory. It wasn't just through football that Drew has become a beacon of hope to New Orleans and the state of Louisiana. Together with his wife, Brittany, he founded the Breeze Dream Foundation to advance research in the fight against cancer and to help rebuild what was lost in Hurricane Katrina. Drew has also written a book entitled Coming Back Stronger, which chronicles his journey with the underlying message of never giving up and following God's plan.
I live for God, for the faith that I have in Him, and knowing the sacrifices that Jesus Christ made on the cross for me, and just feeling like it's in God's hands. And all I have to do is just give it my best, commit the rest to Him, and everything else is taken care of. I mean, that takes a weight off my shoulders. I think that would take a weight off anybody's shoulders. And it's to give you confidence to know that you've got somebody looking out for you.
Amazing, amazing. You know, there is a plan, and God has a plan. And Drew Brees learned that when he was 17, and he's learned it ever since, and he keeps repeating it over and over again in the things he does in his life. God has a plan. And the Bible says God shapes every circumstance together for good to them that love him, to those who are the called according to his purpose. God has a plan for you, and he will shape every circumstance for good because you belong to him. Now you say, well, I don't belong to him. Well, if you don't, let's fix that today. You need to belong to the Lord, and you need to understand what his plan is for you. He's got a plan to bless you and to give you an end, to give you something good. And what he says to you today is, will you trust me? Drew Brees, great athlete, says, I trusted the Lord. I accepted his will for my life, and look what's happened so far. Will you trust the Lord right now? Don't go anywhere. I want you to pray with me. This could be a wonderful opportunity for you. I want you to pray these words, and I want you to mean them in your heart. And let's surrender to the plan of God for you. Lord, pray with me now. That's right. Lord, I know you have a plan for my life. But that plan starts with your death on the cross and your resurrection from the grave. I thank you, Lord, that you died for me. I thank you, Lord, that you rose from the dead and that you live forevermore. Now, right now, I surrender to your plan for me. And Lord, I ask that you might come into my heart, live your life in me, and reveal to me your plan that I might live for you and serve you all the days of my life. Thank you, Lord, that you have heard my prayer. Thank you that you have come into my heart. Thank you that you have saved my soul. Now, I want to pray for you wherever you are. Father, in Jesus' name, may the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit touch everyone who prayed. Reveal your plan for them now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you prayed with me, gave your heart to the Lord, that's such an important decision. There is no greater decision that you could make in life. And I have something for you that'll help you get started. It's a little packet. It's called A New Day. And it has in here a CD. It has 73 minutes, I believe it is, of teaching. Tell you what you've just done, what it means to have an exchange life, what it means to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, what it means to see the second coming of Jesus Christ. I'll give all this to you, plus a little booklet. If you prayed with me, just go to your phones and call and say, I pray with Pat. There's absolutely no financial obligation whatsoever. Totally free. We'll send it to you free. Toll-free number. It's free all the way. 1-800-759-0700. Just call. One of these counselors will be delighted to receive the wonderful news that you have said yes to Jesus and that his plan is going to be worked out in your life. Terry?
Well, still ahead, we'll be praying for you and for your needs. But first, a woman looks in the mirror and sees that her lifelong skin disorder has vanished. Watch how it happens. That's later on today's 700 Club.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. At CBN, we're here to pray for you all year long. But each autumn, the entire staff of CBN sets aside a special week of prayer to pray for your needs. We care about you and the things that are happening in your life. No matter how big or small your requests, we want to pray for you. Please call us or mail your prayer request today. It's our privilege to pray for you.
Hi, I'm Dr. Joyce Brothers. Those of us who are independent and live alone shouldn't do so without having emergency protection. And for reliability and peace of mind, I recommend Alert USA.
With Alert USA, if you ever need assistance, just press your pendant to be connected to an operator who can summon help to your home 24 hours a day.
I've been giving advice for many years, and I believe Alert USA provides the best emergency support and value for your dollar. Call now for a free brochure.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Hopes are fading to rescue people buried beneath landslides in Guatemala. So far, 45 people have died from back-to-back landslides, and many more people are still missing. A tropical depression over the weekend set off 15 landslides over a 48-hour period. Vehicles are trapped, and that's making rescue efforts difficult.
We are very worried seeing these tragedies, which are the result of the severe weather changes affecting us. It is a high risk. We have to check the roads, secure the critical spots.
Authorities say there will be an investigation to determine if faulty road construction may have been a contributing factor to the landslides. The volcano in Indonesia continues to erupt. This morning, ash shot 3 miles into the air. Look at that. Covered villages up to 15 miles away. This is the most powerful eruption since the volcano first came back to life last week. Some scientists are afraid that all of the current activity could be the warning signs of a much more destructive explosion within the next few weeks. So far, more than 30,000 people have been evacuated. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website, that's cbnnews.com. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Hi there, neighbor. Pat Boone here from my good friends at Swiss America, the company that makes retirement dreams come true with gold. A lot of folks are shifting a portion of their retirement funds into a new precious metals IRA with Swiss America. And since 2004, these IRAs are up in value over 150%. I've been a very satisfied client of Swiss America for many years now because they believe in honesty, fair prices, and superior service. It's time to put your financial future on a gold standard right now. I own gold because it's a hedge of protection for my family. Even my grandkids can see that our paper money is becoming less valuable every day. So call or visit Swiss America now. Ask for the Pat Boone free DVD and gold IRA kit. Get the best education you can on gold, the best asset to own during these uncertain times. Call or visit online now.
Tomorrow, meet the natural bodybuilder of the decade and find out what this strong man was trying to hide.
If I could build this armor around myself, then nobody could hurt me again.
Plus, how this man dropped 150 pounds in a year without drugs or surgery.
Constantly setting those smaller goals got me here.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
Piebaldism is a rare skin disorder, and doctors can treat it using skin grafts. Well, Marie Dunn found a cure watching the 700 Club. Take a look.
When I was younger, and we were in the sun a lot because we live in the country, and I started getting these brown spots on my face. I always covered it with makeup because that's where the blush was supposed to go, you know, and here I had these big spots on my cheeks. But as I got older, I thought that's just part of my face and I just need to learn to live with it. One day I was watching the 700 Club and it was Gordon, and he speaks so soft and so sweet.
So let's go to him right now. And let's praise him.
I bowed my head and I was praying with him, you know, and then he just raised up his head and said, someone out there has these brown splotches on their face.
Oh, there's someone with a skin condition on your face and there's blotchy pigment. God is going to heal that for you. It's not going to spread any farther. It's going to actually go back the way it was. Just receive that now in Jesus' name, amen.
I just heard what he had to say and, you know, was just praying with him. And then I got up to go to the bathroom, you know, and when I did, I said, oh my goodness, it was just so apparent, you know, it was the difference was, you know, really great. They were gone, these big brown blotches on the side of my face here, it was gone, they were gone. And I kept saying, oh my goodness, he was talking about me. I can't believe this. And I got the phone and I called the 700 Club and I told them that word of knowledge and about the blotches being taken away just like he said they would. I couldn't believe it. It was just, a miracle, you know, from the grace of God. He's so concerned about all the details of your life. Whatever it is we're going through, he's there and he's going to help us through it. We need to believe that.
He is there. He sees your need. He knows your heart. And it's faith building to see someone like Marie receive a word from the Lord and see that happen immediately.
Yeah.
I mean, immediately.
And again, Gordon had never seen Marie, didn't know anything about her.
Not a thing.
But God knew.
Not a thing.
Okay.
This is Gloria. She lives in Bakersfield, California. She heard you, Pat, give a word of knowledge that there was someone with cloudy eyes being healed. Gloria said her allergies were so bad that her vision was actually cloudy. And as she heard you speak, she shouted, "That's me." You know, it's a funny thing. When you hear a word that's for you, you know it's for you.
Yeah.
You know, immediately her eyes began to clear up. She was able to see, even read small print without her glasses. You also mentioned that diabetes was being healed, so she checked her blood count. It was normal.
Hallelujah.
Really?
Not too bad. Abby, who lived in Ridgeway, Pennsylvania, she's 13 years old. 2 years ago, she began playing basketball, and a month later, she started having pain in her rotator cuff in her left shoulder. Mm. The doctor said you need to ice it, elevate it, and rest your arm. The pain persisted, but she just toughed it out. She kept playing basketball, by the way. Then last July, she was watching this program, and Terry, you gave a word of knowledge that a left shoulder injury to the rotator cuff. She said, "It's so painful, and nothing has been done to heal it. God's touching you."
Wow.
That's what you said. Abby said, "That's me." The pain went away. She hadn't had any more problem. Apparently, the Lord has healed Abby's rotator.
Well, praise the Lord. I know a number of people who have rotator problems, and
terrible.
It is so painful.
Terrible. Well, we're going to join hands together, and we're going to pray for you. Whatever your need is, let's mm-hmm. believe God.
Well,
Father, how we thank you that you're touching people. You're demonstrating that you live. You're demonstrating that you love us. Now, Lord, why should we be amazed that the God of the universe is fixing his creation? You made us, Lord, and there's nothing for you to heal us. So we come before you, Lord, and we ask for miracles. There's somebody being healed right now of ulcerated colitis. This thing's been a problem for quite some time. Just put your hand on your abdomen and just in the name of Jesus, be made whole.
There's somebody else. You've had a lisp all of your life. It's quite noticeable, but God has just set you free from that. It's just like your mouth works differently than it worked before.
Lord.
You're going to be surprised yourself as you speak. Someone else, your left ear, just now, you heard like a crackle and a pop in your ear. God has restored your hearing to you.
Somebody's being healed of painful varicosities in the name of Jesus. You are being completely whole in Jesus' name. And somebody else, you've got bulging veins in your leg. The word name Norma comes to me. Just put your hand on your leg right there and watch those veins go down. Jesus just did a miracle. Terry, what else? Mm-hmm.
Someone else with digestive problems. You've had
Jesus.
It for quite a while. God is just healing that for you. That pressure and that burning sensation is going to go away and you'll not have trouble anymore.
Bless the name of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And we thank you in Jesus' name.
Thank you, God.
Amen. If you want further prayer, please call. We've got folks here all day long and they love to pray for you if you need prayer. And if you've had an answer, we also love to hear from you. It builds our faith, builds the faith of the audience. So just call in. As the Lord has touched you, we want you to call us. So it's time for email.
It is. It's coming up. We've got your email. Mike says, "On my way home from work, I often see a man holding a cardboard sign saying he will work for food. People give him money, but I feel uncomfortable. How do you think Jesus would handle this situation?" We're going to bring it on with Mike's question and more, and that's still ahead.
Rosh Hashanah. For thousands of years, it's been a time of reflection and celebration. Join us live as we celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles and enjoy the music of Paul Wilbur. And hear inspiring teachings by Pat Robertson.
We are celebrating the coming of Jesus Christ.
Be a part of this year's celebration live at CBN.com on September 8th at 7:30 p.m.
If you have diabetes and love food, pay attention to this free offer. Hi, I'm Nicole Johnson, Miss America 1999. I've had diabetes since 1993, and I hate boring food. Well, I got these three free cookbooks with fantastic tasting recipes for people with diabetes. If you have diabetes and have Medicare, you can get these cookbooks free.
Call now to qualify for not one, not two, but three free cookbooks. Call 1-800-584-0860.
You'll love this rich chocolate cake, oven fried chicken, and nachos. You'll also get this free meal planning guide and diabetes magazine. So call now for your free Better Care Kit with three free cookbooks.
To qualify, call 1-800-584-0860. That's 1-800-584-0860.
Focus Factor is America's number one brain health supplement. It nourishes your brain with vitamins, minerals, and essential omega-3 oils to naturally support memory, concentration, focus. Focus Factor, nutrition for the brain. Available at...
Well, a father in this next story faced an impossible task. He had to support a family of five, but guess what he got paid? $4 a day. Four, count them, $4 a day.
Imagine a family of five people living in a house that's 6 by 6 feet square. Well, that's where the Sajamis have lived for the past 4 years. But the family says being crammed together wasn't their biggest problem.
I couldn't stand my children suffering when it rained and everything got wet. Everything turned to mud. Sometimes my children would get sick and their small bodies would ache.
This is Elmer, the children's father. He runs a small water delivery service and makes about $4 a day.
We felt desperate. We just didn't have any money to build a better house.
And Elmer got emotional as we asked him about the impact of their living conditions on the family.
I don't want to remember. Please.
I would pray to God the Lord. You know the condition we are in. Please, help us.
One day, Milagros told her neighbor about their prayers, and that neighbor told them about Operation Blessing. Soon, a volunteer construction team arrived from Operation Blessing with all the materials needed to build the family a new home, one that's a lot bigger than the 6 by 6 foot square house that they'd been renting before.
I thank Operation Blessing for giving us this beautiful house.
Thanks, Operation Blessing, for giving me the house of my dreams.
The house of my dreams, a little shack with a grass roof.
It's all relative, isn't it?
Well,
it's all relative. But it's so, I mean, talk about a wonderful opportunity as we enjoy the favor and the blessings of God here in America to touch someone's life.
Well, the Bible says, you know, we need to be thankful. They said neither were they thankful. And they were talking about, you know, Sodom. They weren't thankful. You know, he wasn't so much talking about their sin as the fact they weren't thankful for the good things God has done for us. If I were you folks, every day you live, thanks God. Every day you live, thank God that you were born or living in America, that you have the freedom, or whatever country you're in where you have freedom, that you've got food and clothing and you have, you know, enough to take care of your family. Thank God. And then one of the ways to show you thank Him is to help others. So if you want to participate with us, please pick up the phone and say, well, I want to show I'm thankful. And here is a gift for people like those folks down in Latin America. Let's go to some
questions. Speaking of a gift, we should say when you join the 700 Club, you get the Secret Kingdom teachings.
You get the Secret Kingdom teachings, Volume 2 on, DVD. Okay.
Indeed. Okay, time for some Bring It On.
Let's do it.
This is Mike, who says, on my way home from work, I often see a man holding a cardboard sign saying he will work for food. Some people give him money, but I feel uncomfortable. How do you think Jesus would handle this situation?
Jesus said, give to those that ask of you. You know, if somebody's hurting, don't turn them away. How would he handle it? He'd give him some money. I tell you, though, when I lived in New York, there were people who were always, they wanted to get money to buy booze. So a guy hit me up on the street, you know, said, I want to go to Staten Island or wherever it was. I've got to get across to Jersey. I've got to have fare for the ferry. But I need something to eat. I'm hungry. I said, okay, I'm going to take you across the street to the automat right across the street, and I'm going to buy you food. He looks so disappointed.
I think you're absolutely right about that, because I've had that happen to me on a number of occasions where people will say that they've run out of gas, and could I give them enough money to get back home? They live across the state line.
Yeah.
And after you're asked that two or three times, you think, you know, there's something going on here. So, I think giving them, if they need food, you give them food.
Yeah,
but not
and if,
always
if
money.
They need gas, find their car, take it to a filling station, put a couple of dollars
put
worth of gas
in the car.
Yeah. All right, what else?
This is Eric, who says, I know the Bible talks about generational curses and that we need to break those. Are there such things as generational curses, and how can I pass those on to my family?
Well, God says that I will bless those to the third and fourth generation, actually to thousands of generations of those who love me. And the sins of the fathers will be visited to the third and fourth generation. You can look at a lot of things genetically. You can look at cultural. You can look at predisposition to sin and to alcoholism and so forth. And you add it all up and down, and the answer is they do go through generations. How do you break it? You've got to specifically break the curse in Jesus' name, speak it clearly, and then act accordingly.
I want to say that we have more information about generational curses on our website. You really do need to find out about this. Go to CBN.com, click on the Bring It On Extra link. Okay, Pat, this is Kirk who says, I'm concerned about how Islam is taking over much of our world. In addition to praying, do you have some suggestions of how we can stop its progression in our country?
Yeah, you can help CBN. We have more Arabic language Christian programming than any other organization in the world. And we have all kinds of programs. We have full language Farsi. We have Urdu. We have all kinds of things. And big ministry to the Kabyle Berbers in North Africa. What do? Well, you
share the gospel.
Take them something better. That's what you do. You take them the love of God and say, Jesus loves you, and here it is. But you don't. It's better to light a candle than to curse the darkness. What else?
Josiah says, is there a difference between an atheist and an agnostic? My roommate says neither one believes in God, so what do they believe?
Not true. Gnosis, G-N-O-S-I-S, is the word for knowledge, and agnostic means I don't know. Theist is God, and A means no God, and an atheist says there is no God, an agnostic says I just don't know about him.
Yeah, if you can show me, if you can give me.
Yeah, yeah. But
facts.
I mean, it may have the same practical end, but that's the way they work. Hey, that's all the time we've got. Thanks for those questions, and we leave you today with these words from Romans 12:21: Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. That's just exactly what I was talking about. Amen. I'm glad Paul got there first. Tomorrow's Skinny Wednesday. You'll find a guy that lost 100 pounds and one of the best muscle builders you ever saw. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. From Thailand to South Africa, from Ukraine to India, and many places in between, I've had the privilege of seeing the incredible work CBN partners are accomplishing. You've brought help and hope to so many people and changed their lives forever. Just like you did for Hannah. This 15-year-old was forced to leave home because her parents could no longer afford to feed her. While working as a maid, she saw a CBN program and received Jesus as her Savior. Now her life is filled with joy and hope. Each month, your gift makes it possible to feed the hungry, help disaster victims, heal the sick, and broadcast the gospel. So please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. Thank you for joining with us. And here's something wonderful I hope you'll remember. Somewhere in this world, someone is thanking God because you were there.